yourself or to say something about yourself. And before I get to that part, maybe I'm not going to speak on my own all afternoon. As every good academic, I've got slaves doing most of the work. So have them know more about the topic than I do. So I'm going to introduce them as they come out themselves. But I just wanted to say a little bit of background about where does it come from. From home, my home language is German. I've been only to German private schools all of my life, and then I came to Stellenbosch, and lo and behold, all of a sudden I had to find out that all the textbooks are in English, and all the lectures are in Afrikaans. And it was a bit of a nightmare to adapt to. But the advantage that at that stage was maybe that if I look at my undergrad class, we were sort of 14, 15 students undergrad. So if you battled with the language, the lecturer could explain it to you again. There was sufficient time for that. And when I did my postgrad studies, there were three of us. So again, it was an advantage. If you were sick, the lecture was postponed. If you didn't understand, repeated it again. So it was easy in that kind of regard. Then, if you look at saying, where does the interest come from in teaching, visualization, whatever else? When I looked at the working environment, or when I started working, one of the first things I battled with again was communication barriers. You go out as an engineer and you think you know it all, and now you want to implement something. And the first day you ask someone to do something, you get that blank stare to say, I'm not sure what you're telling me. So I just want to show you an example of saying, how can one do it in a working environment? How do you communicate with people? And please don't take the next slide as the opening to say, this is what you're going to do, or this is how things can be done. But you've got a program where we can say we want to improve productivity in the workplace called 20 Keys. And why use that as an example? They want to do everything, saying the first is you should clean and organize, but they try and control that in a visual kind of format to say, this is what we're trying to achieve, so that communication and understanding becomes easier. And so that was the first thing. And I came back and said, well, if you talk to managers, that all of us, okay, engineers and nerds, we all know them, and we like our figures. MATLAB or whatever else, the more mathematics in there, the better for us it is. But if you again come back and say, well, you actually look at data presentation to management, you have to convey something, then all of a sudden those figures don't make sense anymore. So if you look and say, what are we doing? For instance, we've got a master's student who finished last year, and simply said, we're improving information reporting in data intensive organizations, depending on the preferences of management. And just to show you a very simplified example of that, if you have two companies, we say, well, these are the KPIs that we're looking at. We're looking at quality, time, cost, whatever else the case might be. Then we can simply say, well, different companies rate it at a different importance level. So for company A, quality might be the most important, company B, the other one might be more important. But this isn't very appealing to anyone. So we could try and highlight it more and say, well, for A, these two are the most important ones. For B, these three are the most important ones. Or you can use graphs to illustrate that. Have something like a radar graph in Excel to say, well, this is what's important for company A or B, this is what's important for company A. So there are various ways of conveying the same kind of information. Then we came back to Stellenbosch University, said, well, in undergrad, the sort of class sizes that we lectured in engineering, sort of they've increased from 40, 60, at the moment we had 100 in our class, our department, but the largest classrooms are sort of 180, which might not be sound too big for many of you, I guess. There's a lot of students. I was in the postgrad level, we have 50, 60 master students now to whom you have to teach. Now it becomes sort of an issue again to say it's one-way trip. You've got a lecture, you present something, you walk out and you forget about it. And if you look at technology, we're using transparencies and whiteboards, or we use that. Then you've got laptops, and all of us said, great, now we've got sort of we're technology savvy. What are we doing? And some of my colleagues are going to expand on that. Basically using PowerPoint, using the same thing as we did previously on transparency, only now we're going to have it on other. And if you look at the standard functionality that's available, only speaking of myself, I'm using very, very limited functionality. There's so much you can do on that, but as always, it's on my to-do list, and I never get around to actually doing it or using it. So if you look back at that and say, that's a one part, that's a teaching part. If you look at industry push from industry, then we're talking about what's referred to as the fourth industrial revolution. And I don't want to bore you with the detail of that, and it's quite self-explanatory. But certainly in the 1780s, we had first sort of steam engine where we could automate something. Then in the 1930s, we had open industrialization where we had conveyor belts and could automate a lot of things. The most famous one, probably assembly line of Henry Ford, although he wasn't first one to use it. Then in the 1950s, we had sort of the microelectronics kind of revolution, which made it possible to then have electronic automation. And now the sort of the word that is in quite the fourth industrial revolution, which makes these psychophysical systems to automate things even more. So if you look at maybe the last couple of centuries, not centuries, the last 20 years, we had the IT Age in 1990. Then we sort of said, well, do everything on the internet. Then we brought the humans into it again. We sort of saved everything on the cloud, somewhere up there, cloud that no one needs our data. Then we sort of disintermediated again to sort of say we have to collaborate on the same kind of data amongst different people of us. And ultimately we try to say, well, maybe we're going to sort of an autonomous era where we can sit in a car and the car drives itself with all the data that comes from somewhere. Given that this is when will this future arrive? Now, just now, I had some of the things in here from World Economic Forum to say, well, 10% of people of my way of traveling is connected to the internet in 5 years' time. The first robotic pharmacist in the United States, and 90% of the response said, this is going to be with us in 7 years. And maybe one of us said, it's going to take our jobs away, and maybe the first artificial intelligence machine is going to sit on corporate board of directors. So maybe we have artificial intelligence teaching people as well. Given this, if you then look and say, as a background, what does this mean for industry? Then the term industry 4.0 is actually originated in Germany, and some of the Germans insist it's a German word. So you can't translate it to industry, it's industry. They write it like that as well. But I'm just going to use it interchangeably. So what's the implication of that? You've got automated kind of factories in here, which work with robotic systems, automated systems. You've got people who are working from home, who are connected to all of those items. You have interfaces that give you the state of your factory at any single moment in time. You've got information systems behind it which capture all the data of the transactions, convert them, and give you the information for that. You've got 3D printing or new technology that produces something. And we've got sort of hopefully greener energy to use with it. And this is kind of what industry envisages and says, well, this is where we're going. What are the implications of that though? If you look at those digital disruptions, it brings opportunities, but you're not sure whether it's to the advantage of all of us or not. If you look at companies again, then 83% of them believe that non-prediction startups are going to come in to take their business away. 52% of them are actually concerned about becoming obsolete, saying, well, there's no business model. It doesn't make sense anymore to have a taxi if anyone can run for something. Or to have a courier service. If you now have apps that say, you can take anyone if you're going to Cape Town, please take this along and deliver. So there are new technologies that may come forward and disrupt ourselves. So what's the background, or what is the effect of that on human beings? We have to use that technology. And we've got a host of kind of studies that say, well, how do you prepare students for this fourth industrial engineering or industrial revolution? And we have to talk about that so as to make sure that we don't become obsolete ourselves. Say, well, the industrial revolution is over, we won. Then we're sitting there not being able to do anything anymore. And if you now come back and say, well, education training, it's done, Bush. I started with our small classes, and I started playing board games with them in finances, in financial courses. We played a game based on rich dad, poor dad. But instead of lecturing about it, we simply played a board game. We also use something that many of us, if not most of us, are familiar with. We use Lego blocks to create factories. Automated factories, where we have controllers, motors, drive a whole factory, or at least a simulation of a factory with Lego blocks and Lego bricks. Which work pretty well, but it's only useful for other individuals, like in this case, where it was a five-year project that very specific students could do. Or the board games for very small classes. If you have a class of 4 or 5, then yes, it makes sense, otherwise you can't do it. And then in the 90s, I went to the Netherlands on a course. Then we played what's referred to as a beer game. And so if you Google on a beer game, it's not our South African version of a beer game. It's actually a simulation of distribution networks. And this is the kind of environment you play, and you play as a group with the whole board, and you have different broad players, etc. And I thought that's a pretty smart one, and I took that concept and developed it inside further and put it in differently. And I keep on playing that every year, and I've probably played it more than, I'm not sure how often, 200 times, in various environments, with students, with school kids, with in the industry, with employees. And the worst people you can play it with are CAs. My experience, sample of one. The CA is always there to say, I have to balance the books, and this doesn't balance yet, so we can't continue until it balances. But you know, that kind of concept, and that's it. But does the games you're playing, do they actually contribute towards learning? Because I keep on saying, well, yes, the beer game is great. And the A students, if you see them 10 years later, 5 years later, they all say, the only thing I remember is that stupid game. What was the game that we played in? That's about the only thing that I remember. So, with that, I'd like to give a hand up to Vika Emin, who's a current master's student, and for her final project, she's trying to develop or look at a model and saying, do these games actually contribute in any way towards understanding the students? So, Vika, over to you.
Hi everyone, I'm Mika, and I'm going to talk about the tool I developed to measure the learning success of the sound learning computer games. Gamification can be defined as the use of game design elements in non-gaming contexts. It introduces the idea of using games and elements of games in education to provide an environment that the youth of today can possibly relate to. Since Generation Y has grown up with technologies and games being part of their everyday lives, therefore gamification or learning by doing was investigated as a possible solution to our education problems and skill shortage in our country. The goal was to determine whether the learning contribution of the Stellenbosch learning factory games is significant and measurable. This goal was achieved by developing a three-dimensional matrix to measure the learning success of the games. The five games that was investigated is the following. The first game, the beer game, is a supply chain game that simulates the interaction between the different supply chain participants and teaches students theories such as the brewer effect. The second game, the Lego car game, teaches the students theories such as production management, lean management, and 5S theory. The third game, the train game, shows how to improve the assembly line by using theories such as value chain mapping, 5S and Kanban. The fourth game, the off-road Lego car game, shows how continuous improvements of workstations and warehouse layout can help to meet the customer demand more efficiently. The fifth game, the fresh connection game, it's a supply chain game that the students play over a period of 5 weeks. The main goal of the game is to make the company profitable again, and each player has a different role within the company, and each role's decisions influence one another. These games don't only teach the students these theories, but they get to experience the improvement impact that these theories has on a supply chain or production line. The learning success criteria were based on a revised Bloom's taxonomy, and to quantify for a fun element, or in classic terms, learning motivation, self-determination theories and the human needs theories were investigated. These three theories were used to develop a three-dimensional matrix with knowledge on the x-axis, abstraction on the y-axis, and emotional immersion on the z-axis. The criteria were used to develop questionnaires that was distributed to students participating in these games, and the questionnaire results clearly indicated that all of the games satisfies the highest two levels of learning success. These results were used to develop a three-dimensional matrix in RStudio, and from the matrix we can clearly see that the fresh connection game has the highest learning success. This is due to the game requiring greater autonomy and in-depth engagement over a longer period of time. This is considered where the most learning takes place. We can also see that the off-roader mega car game and the beer game has a lower learning success. This is due to the gain taking place over a short period of time, which could lead to information overload and therefore also less in-depth engagement can take place. To conclude, the goal was achieved as a tool, a three-dimensional matrix was developed to measure the learning success. This matrix can be used in the future at the Salamos Learning Factory to measure the learning success of the games and to test the learning success before finalizing the development of a new game, or it can be used to improve the learning success of an existing game. I just want to end off with a quote by John Dewey. If we teach today's students as we taught yesterday's, we rob them of tomorrow. Thank you.
So when Mika first came up, he showed me and said, if you don't like your beer game, I was totally disgusting, so that's stupid. Yeah, I thought this. But that's for the existing games that you played in there, where you simply tried to imagine, saying, is there a way to actually see whether it make a difference, yes or no? The second part of it is we said, okay, these are existing games that you teach in the classroom and that you use in the classroom. But what about the technology push, the technology that industry actually needs? And we don't have physical labs, so they're usually expensive, but what we're trying to do is we're trying to become part of a global, let's call it an international network, where universities and industry trying to build, let's call it, simulated working environments or laboratories where you can actually get a hands-on experience on some of these things. And well, we had a good fortune in Salamos that you said we became part of what's called this Learning Factories network, which is mainly centered in Germany. But the factories or this concept applied in industry and universities vastly all over the world. One of them in China, and then originally they wanted to build a facility in Johannesburg, but we convinced them to say Stellenbosch is actually far better to build a facility like that. So we got involved in this network, and we've got an existing facility that we're building up at the moment. And our first couple of master students have implemented it over there. Maybe just saying it's sort of the proof concept by now, it's also approved by the quite globally most acknowledged engineering society that we have, was also. We say there is space for something like that, and we should contribute to that. And we have sort of annual conferences based purely on this concept, how are you planning, what are you planning, what are you doing, with different learning factories using different technologies and different purposes in there. And I could convince one of my previous students and Kelyota into saying, skip your lunch break, and please come here and tell us something more about the work that he did in Stellenbosch in our department, and effectively all the facility that you have out there. So Carl, over to you. Thanks for skipping lunch.
So I think just to link up to what Conrad said before, with industry changing so much, and this massive push from our environmental situation, I mean, Cape Town was just testing one of those, there's such a driver for companies to improve on their resource usage and make better use of employees while also giving them better environments. And together with that, then we have, yes, Industry 4.0, or whatever the Germans want to call it, Industry 4.0. We've got so much data hanging around, but you know, in South Africa, we're not doing much with that. So, and our skills are changing. You know, people no longer need to sit and put files together, but they need to know how to interact with machine interfaces and with robots, you know, because as artificial intelligence is growing, you need to adapt and change and know how to work with that. So, as Conrad said, learning factories were built to replicate SMEs. So I'm just going to throw some figures out there. I'm really sure I'm in the ballpark. But they make up something like 60% of companies around the world, where normally you think that the big corporates are much bigger, but SMEs are bigger. So SMEs are replicated in these learning factories. And now throughout my masters, I realized that everyone agreed, okay, Industry 4.0 is definitely the way to go. We can't be behind, and only realize afterwards we needed to do that. Let's do this. Now everyone's like, okay, but how do we do it? No one knew. So then I started off, and then my project was to create a piecewise framework for the implementation of Industry 4.0. that will lead SMEs and in turn learning factories to successfully implement it and demonstrate it to industry so that they can use it and teach employees and students, as Devin will explain later, so that we can bridge this gap between students leaving school and then requiring 2 or 3 years in undergrad programs in order to add value to a company. So this is what my framework looked like. So right at the bottom, pointer, top, there we go. There's competencies. So in order to fall into teaching students, what we have at the bottom of the competencies is targeted industry-related skills that we wish to develop through industry 4.0 applications. So this is the congregation of current technologies that we found and that's being developed within industry that are taught through various methods like Kanban systems in production and something like that, and how that can change through industry 4.0. A system node is the combination of objects that form a function within a company or whatever. Objects are the smallest piece that you can find. So that can be a small bin where you put parts in, or a microcontroller, and then technologies or software enable the objects to function properly. So yeah, so we've gone through that now. Then, within my framework, there's 3 types of ways you can use it. You can do a greenfield design. So in the learning factory, if you've got nothing existing, you can start right at the bottom and say, okay, which competencies would we like to teach? And then build it from that way up, making sure that you relate each of the levels together. The next one is industry 4.0 redesign, where we had in Germany, they had lots of technology and robots standing everywhere, but nothing was linked. So we said, okay, we would like to redesign this learning factory so that we can teach certain competencies through industry 4.0. And then obviously the last one is an industry 4.0 greenfield design to say, okay, we don't really care much about the competencies, we would like to target industry to show them what's possible through industry 4.0. Okay, so just a quick example, so just a competency, say we would like to teach some smart logistics. Then we link it up to the industry 4.0 application. You can see it, intelligent transport, smart manufacturing, and collaborative work between robots and humans. The next one is the methods, which obviously link to the industry 4.0 application. And as we go up, you can see this tree diagram forming, and then seeing how they all relate together and making sure that we can build the chain from the competencies up to the very top of technologies and software to ensure successful application. Okay, then just the use case we have in Stellenbosch Learning Factory, you can see over here, this is the current setup where they build this model train. I'm not sure what the ratio is, but nevertheless. Then it goes through each of these stations, typical in the South African SME, where you put a part over here, you move it on. But there's so much data lying around which we are not capturing. You know, so, and without that, we can't improve upon any processes or realize where our mistakes are or what we need to improve further. So I went and I implemented this industry 4.0 framework on there, and then we realized we need to visualize this data so then people can actually see what's going on, because it's very difficult in South Africa where we have lots of illiterate people working together with highly literate people. How do you convey information to them? We said, okay, well firstly we need to make sure that they understand the processes that they are going through, and then we need to display it to them. So at the current, so how we explained here to the bin setup, so once the parts are finished, you go from your station with your detailed work instructions, walk to the warehouse, look at what parts you need, then fill up your bin, give them your bin instructions, then later on, when the worker gets back after lunch, you bring his the parts you need and you can carry on with production. So what I then implemented was visual work instructions, so lights go on the bins, okay, based on as you go through your work, you just tap a button and it's sequenced according to the predetermined work instructions. So here you can see there, there's a light that goes on, and as soon as you finish with the current task, you just press the button and it'll tell you which next part to take out of the bin and where to carry on. As soon as your parts are finished in the bin, this can be based on weight sensors or whatever is available, sends a Wi-Fi signal to the warehouse. Lights go on with the Wi-Fi in the warehouse telling you, okay, these bins, parts need to be picked and brought back to which workstation. So you can see workstation 1, refill bins, and the lights will go on at the workstation. What's nice about this being on Wi-Fi is now it's being displayed visually inside the learning factory. So we can see, okay, well, this is the work rate at workstation one, or why is workstation one not working? You know, these things are coming up, and our managers can talk to the employees and say, look here, this is the problem, we can pick it up, you know, how can we work towards fixing this? But now, so yeah, you can see, and then you can replace it. So the problem with this now is with all these technologies, and our training needs a complete overhaul. Because now they're working with high technologies, and where they don't have previous training, with a lot of them are coming from schooling systems where they've maybe left after grade 6, 8, or 10. Now you're forcing them to work with something they're not used to, and that's completely unfair.
But we actually don't even need to look as far as our jobs to realize the impact that technology is having. If we look at just things we do every day, shopping, we went from, you know, going to grocery stores, filling up the bags, now we've got online shopping. If you look at banks, you stood in a queue on a Saturday morning, now we've got mobile banking, we've got internet banking. If we look at how memories used to be captured, you had a film camera which you had to go have develop, hope that maybe one or two photos were good, stuck them in a big album. Today, we've got digital cameras, we've got Instagram, we've got Facebook, we've got thousands of photos uploaded onto the internet. Then communication. You wrote a letter, posted it, hoped that it arrived within, you know, before Christmas or before the birthday you'd sent it for. Today we've got emails, WhatsApp, you pick up the phone, Skype, WhatsApp calls, you name it. You can reach someone instantly no matter where they are in the world. Then something, health and fitness. Okay, the running hasn't changed, you still need to run to get fit, but the way that you measured it has changed. A couple of years ago, all you had was you could stand on a scale or you could take a measuring tape. Today, we've got watches that tell you how far to run, how many calories you've burned. You know, you wear a watch and it tells you everything. It tells you when to run, how far to run, and when to run again. So technology has really changed a lot of things, but there are a few things that it has not changed, and that's the problem. So if you look at education, 30 years ago, this was a lecture hall. You had lecturers standing in front of a blackboard writing some sums on board. Today, we've got a lecture hall that looks the same, and we've got a lecturer standing in front of a PowerPoint presentation teaching some sums. And this is where the problem comes in. So technology has changed every aspect of our daily lives and our work lives, and education has simply stayed exactly the same. So we're teaching the same concepts in the same way, we're just putting it in a digital format. The result? The classroom full of students sleeping. But on a more serious note, we have a big issue with unemployment, especially in South Africa. And not just the general unemployment rate, but if we look at the youth unemployment rate, it's currently at 36%. Now, an even bigger problem, the youth absorption rate is 30%. So we have a youth participation rate of 68%. So this means that approximately 33% of our youth are unemployed and are not actively seeking work. So they're just doing nothing. They've pretty much given up. We've got the problem that we have graduates that cannot find work. And even the graduates that do find work, employers are saying that you can't teach them. They think they know everything, but they don't know anything at all. And they've kind of been termed the lost generation. And this is something that I wanted to look at because I don't think that it's our fault as such, nor is it the older generation's fault. It's just something that has happened. So if we look at what technology has created, we have the digital immigrants, which is, you know, the older generation. They were introduced to technology slowly. Some of them adapted. Some have sort of been left behind, but they're still there. And then we have the younger generation, so the digital native. So these are people who have grown up with digital technologies, not just games, but cell phones. If you give a two-year-old an iPad, they know exactly what to do with it. Control. They like fast pace. They like doing 10 things at the same time. They like graphics, games, visuals, and, you know, not a lot of text and boring stuff. So the issue with this is, and I want to take a quote by Kerensky, who says that today's students are no longer the people that our education system was designed to teach. We've got a totally different generation, and the current education system is just insufficient. So I'm with Industry 4.0 and Smart Technologies in the Workplace, where it's predicted that half the jobs that we have today will no longer exist tomorrow, and half the jobs of tomorrow don't exist yet today. So now we have the youth who can't find jobs, those that do find jobs aren't good at their jobs, and we don't even know what the jobs tomorrow will be. So this is the question that I've been busy with for the past 3 years, is How do we educate the unemployable for a future that does not yet exist? So just looking at a bit more why we are failing, or why our education system is failing. If we look at the standard teaching, you've got the well-known S-curve, which everyone probably knows. You've got intermittent periods of forgetting, so you know more of lectures, you kind of forget about them, and then you pick up next week's lecture again. And the red curve is basically a resultant learning curve. But at some point you do reach a plateau and you say, okay, I've learned everything I could learn in this subject, and that's it. So if we look at what we actually want, we want this kind of continuous learning curve where every time just before you've reached your plateau or your maximum skill ability, we introduce a new aspect and you now get at the bottom of a new learning curve so you can continuously just build up your skill set and continue learning. So if you look at a way to do this, or something that already does this inherently, is video games. If you look at a video game, you play level one, just before you've perfected level one, level two unlocks, and you start level two. Try level two a few times, start level two, level three times. So every time you've just mastered a skill, a new skill is added. So why not use this in our education? So not only does it give you a continuous learning curve, it's obviously appealing to the digital native or to the younger generations. Your difficulty level that you're at is always perfectly matched to your skill set. So if you're not ready for level two, you can't play level two, you're still on level one. You have unlimited attempts, so I can continuously try level one and fail, and I'll just restart the game and try again. Then, in addition, it teaches you some valuable skills. So playing games teaches you to think on your feet. You have to react to sudden and unforeseen events in the game. And it forces you to change course and make decisions instantly. And these are exactly the skills that are demanded from our youth today, from industry, due to Industry 4.0. So this is what I've been looking at, is specifically video games or computer games for education. And I developed an initial prototype last year that is going to be used in Germany for an industry seminar. I'm just going to show you a quick video of it. So it's for a shop floor seminar. And basically it starts off, players can choose their own avatar, a bit of customization. And we tested this with students. So we did a test, so a theoretical test. Some played the game, the control group attended lectures and tested them again. We tested it with industry employees that had actually attended the seminar before the game was introduced. And we tested it with quite a few lecturers as well to see would they be willing to use something like this. The results. So average test scores increased significantly more by those that played the game as opposed to those that just attended lectures. Learning time was faster, but obviously also because the students had played video games before. They believed that it enhanced their learning process, and most believed that it would be able to provide a more sustainable long-term learning effect than just normal lectures. But the most interesting feedback we actually got when we asked for, you know, how could this game be improved, or what recommendations would you give to change the game, is that every single person gave a different answer. So some of the older people would like more theoretical questions, they wanted longer questions. Some of the younger guys wanted multiplayer modes and different information formats. So basically everyone wanted something different. And this kind of led us to what I'm working with now, is that you need a personalized game. So video games are great, but you need video games that are going to adapt to the specific individual that's playing. And this is what I'm looking at now. So the goal is that if we have a classroom full of students and they're all playing the video game, that by using big data, analytics, and real-time cloud computing, we can personalize and adapt the game to the player's interactions with the game while they're playing. So what we're hoping to achieve is that each individual student playing, their learning curve will look slightly different. Some students might take a bit longer, some students might be a bit faster, but ultimately they're all going to reach the final level in the game. And on top of that, another big thing is obviously the lecturers. So educators are used to educating how they've been doing it for the past 30 years. And you can't just kind of tell them now, okay, here's a video game, this is how you're going to do it from now on. So what I'm also looking at is how can we include the educators? How can we help them use this to help these students? So it's going to be a tool for students and educators. And here for educators, this real-time adaptation will be presented to the educators in the form of visual dashboards. So the educator can at any point in time log into the game, see where all his students are, his or his students are, where they're getting stuck, what are they struggling with, what levels are they on, and can kind of then intervene where needed based on that. So this is what I'm looking at now. The next question is, of course, how do we incorporate this into our curriculums? And that's what Devin is going to touch on next.
Thanks, Tanya. Maybe with that, as board presentations, you do a lot of planning before the time, and then things fall apart. So as a summary for what you presented today, I have to unfortunately still, out as I am, I'm in the outmoded mode of teaching. So my students are writing a test at 2 o'clock. but I brought a colleague of mine along, Harald Hansen, who's going to do the closure and sort of say, how do we try and incorporate these things back into our curriculum to actually be able to use? Because part of that is fun, part of that is boring, part of that is frustrating, but we have to try and get back to it. So from my side, thanks a lot for your attendance, but I'm not a duck. The difficult questions come, I'm not going to be here, but it's very fun. Thanks a lot.
Okay, so basically I will be talking to you guys about curriculum and how to include it in, and how to include games, gamification in Industry 4.0 into the curriculum. Obviously just Industry 4.0 for our cases, but new technology for everyone else. So effectively we have the Stellenbosch Learning Factory, okay? The Stellenbosch Learning Factory is a factory that we put together, as you guys have seen, that we can show industry. It's almost like a mock-up of industry, okay? And we had to build a framework on how to develop a learning factory. So we looked at it like this. So we got the learning factory, we looked at the curriculum that needs to go in the learning factory, we looked at the product as well as the facility itself. Okay? So the product, each product can show different different lessons to different students, and the facility as well, the layout. We also need a specific layout. So we did it. You can do it in two ways. You can do it with a facility or product pull or a curriculum push. So where the curriculum is basically dictating what you need to buy, or the facilities are pulling out to coming to curriculum and saying, these are the tools we have, how can you include this in the curriculum? So the Stellenbosch Learning Factory, we have a lot of courses, so manufacturing system, manufacturing processes, production management, quality assurance, and industrial ergonomics, and how do we get all of those into the learning factory? Or at least include some of them in the learning factory. So what we do is we basically break down curriculum into its core lessons and concepts. Okay? So we've got manufacturing systems there. This is taken out of the faculty guidelines or what we should be teaching the students. So we've already got that. That was decided by all the faculty. And now we break it down into their core lessons. Okay, so CAM, we have CAM, CIM, FEM, and CAE. And then we have part inspection, quality control, coordinated measuring machines, 3D scanners. So these are new concepts or concepts that we want to teach the students. We want them to go out into industry and know about. So then we also now need to make sure that industry or EXA, the Engineering Council of South Africa, is happy. So what we also do is we compare the broad competencies that they need to know. So we go and get EXA's guidelines on what competencies we are teaching, we need to teach. So we get those from them, we then look at the concepts covered, and we break down the courses into their fundamental competencies and lectures, or lessons. Then, now we need to see where the industry push is, okay? So we look at technology. What's the technology push, the industry push? So everyone knows there's Industry 4, but now, how do we get our curriculum from Industry 3.0 to Industry 4.0? Now that's the biggest problem, okay? The current curriculum is outdated. We aren't teaching nearly enough on Industry 4.0. We're teaching Industry 3.0, in some cases Industry 2.0, because it hasn't been updated. And the way we found out to do this was by basically mapping out Industry 4.0 value drivers, the digital compass of Industry 4.0. Okay? So we've got all the Industry 4.0 levers and the value drivers that are important for Industry 4.0 concepts as well as for industries. Like Carl showed you, that Industry 4.0 has an industry push. So basically, in this case, I'm going to take you to look at quality, digital quality management, advanced process control, and statistical process control. So now, where do we go? We go back to our broken down version, and we say, okay, quality control, part inspection. This is where we can implement that Industry 4.0 value driver. So then we break down that and put it into a matrix and break down every single course and their value drivers and link it to the course. So we say, okay, what can we teach in manufacturing systems? For manufacturing systems, from Industry 4.0, we can do routing flexibility, machine flexibility. And from quality spectrum, we can teach digital quality management, advanced process control. So these are parts that we can actually now say, Industry 4.0, okay, we need to now aim curriculum to this. We can develop a third course, and we can then bring the students from class to the learning factory. So we can now have them, instead of giving them a lecture like this, we can now go and say, okay, everyone, today we're not having a lecture in the lecture hall, the boring method. We're going to take them to the learning factory, and you guys are going to do practically and learn practically and see how to do it on a practical scale. And then we've got Mika's games that we can also play. Okay, so this is all done in the learning factory. But we've also then got Tanya's section with regards to the games on the phones, okay, using technology. So then you can now take technology with you home and do a lecture at home effectively. Okay, you can have a digital lecture, or you can have a game where you're playing and the lecturer asks you questions when you get to the lecture. So we're working on certain games like that as well. Currently, this is what we've done with regards to publications. We've developed a framework for Learning Factory for industrial engineering education in South Africa. And this will be presented at the South African Institute for Industrial Engineering Conference next week. And just to conclude, to just tie everything together, we have a very old, outdated education system. We have an industry push or a technology push. We have a method to break down our curriculum. We have training, we have games that we can use in our curriculum. We have a way to rank these games on the learning ability. And we have an app or apps and a technology that we can use to teach the students anywhere and teach them individually. Okay? Einstein said, if you judge a fish on its ability to climb a tree, it will go on thinking it's stupid, okay? So, what's next? This is why we're here. I'm going to ask you guys, what's next? Thank you.